Robert explains how our emotions rule us and how we let fear dictate whether we're going to take action or not.
I realized that the world was open for me. I didn't have to contain myself within that that box.
I have gained so much control over my life. I've gained happiness. I've gained freedom. I'm just getting started.
But what I like about New York is the energy, the vibrancy, and it's really the land of opportunity here. Where I learned about business was not in business school, but on the streets. This was my business school. This is capitalism at its best, also its worst. Well, just look around you, man. This is the best city in the whole world. It's where money is made and it drives the rest of the world's economy. You know, when people talk about achieving their dreams, tonight was going beyond dreams, beyond reality. Rich Dad Poor Dad started because when I wrote the book, nobody wanted it. No publisher would take it. Book distributor said it was a joke. Bookstore says, who are you? You're not a writer. So we put one copy in a gas station in Austin, Texas, and it took off. It's like I said, now it's in 38 different languages. It went by word of mouth. And then 2 years after we published the book, Oprah called, and the rest is history.
When I picked up the Rich Dad, Poor Dad book, the readability of the book caused me to pick it up and not be able to put it down. So I read it from cover to cover almost in one sitting.
I really didn't have any concept of really what it took, money, cash flow, how to really make a business work, even though I was running a business. Now I understand the importance of getting the right people on your team.
Tonight I'm going to go into the basics of why professional investors make money and why average investors lose money. And I think it'll open people's eyes up as to why the rich get richer and why everyone else is working harder and paying more taxes.
Thank you and enjoy the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Robert Kiyosaki.
Thank you. How many people have read Rich Dad Poor Dad? Good, thank you. Who has not yet read the book? Good. Thank you very much for coming here. For those who have not read the book, I'll give a little of my background on the book and all this. I was born in Hawaii, and I was born in a little sugar plantation town. And at the age of 18, I won a congressional appointment to the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy here in New York. And so at the age of 18, I came for the very first time to New York, and I was this little hayseed kid straight off the boat from Hawaii. And I still remember walking around the streets of Manhattan. I had blue jeans on. I mean, real blue. I mean, powder blue. And I had my little powder blue surfer shoes on. And I had a blue and white Aloha shirt on. And I remember walking through some little rough parts of Manhattan. All these guys are going, hey, baby, how you doing? You know, I said, are they insinuating something here and all this? And I was dressed like a Hawaii kid. And then went out to the academy out here. And I never went back. I mean, I came to New York, and I fell in love with this place. It's a fabulous place to live. After graduating here in 1969, the Vietnam War was still on, and I had to make a decision. Was I going to, I mean, I had a draft exempt because I was in a non-defense vital industry. I was in shipping. And I had a good job with Standard Oil of California. And yet both of my dads, my rich dad and my poor dad, said to me, is the responsibility of a son to go fight for his country. So at that point, I only worked for Standard Oil for about a month, and I resigned from that high-paying job. It wasn't that much, but it was about $42,000 a year back in 1969. And that's worth a lot more today. But the best thing about it, I only had to work 7 months out of a year. I had 5 months vacation, so it was a pretty good thing. So I resigned from that, and I went to Pensacola, Florida, and joined the Marine Corps. And I became a helicopter pilot. I flew the helicopter gunship and I went to Vietnam. And I came back from there and then I went back into business after I got out of the war. So Rich Dad Poor Dad had a big influence on my decision not to go into the world of government where my dad said. My dad was the head of education for the state of Hawaii, very smart man, very well-educated man, and he always said to me, go to school, get good grades, so I can get a safe, secure what? Job. And I said, okay. So when I came marching back home from war in 1974, my dad had been fired. And he was a superintendent of education. At 50 years old, he was fired because he made the tragic mistake of running for lieutenant governor of the state of Hawaii as a Republican. Now, for those who know anything about Hawaii, Forbes magazine calls Hawaii the People's Republic of Hawaii. So my dad actually thought he could make a change, and he ran for office and was wiped out. He was decimated. The problem was he ran against his boss, who is the governor. Very tragic mistake. And he thought no hard feelings, you know. So he went back to his boss and he said, you know, can I get my job back? And the governor says, not only do you not get a job back, you'll never work in the state again in government. So here's my dad, 50 years old. He has no job because he's blacklisted from government. All he ever knew was government. He went into school as a kindergarten kid and stayed in the school system all his life. And at 50 years old, he's thrown into the real world. So I come marching back from war in 1974, and I say, Dad, what are you doing? He says, well, I'm looking for a job. And I said, at 50 years old. He says, what are you going to do, son? He says, you know, I was offered to fly for Western Airlines. I said, I don't want to be a pilot anymore. I've flown enough. He says, are you going back to being a sailor? I said, no, I don't want to be an employee anymore. I don't want to sail. He says, what, then you're going back to get your master's degree? I said, on the 12th. He said, the 12th of what? I said, never, you know. And he goes, but you got to get a degree. Then you get your PhD, you know, and all this stuff. And I said, I don't think so, Dad. He says, but you got to get a job, you know, go back to school so you can get a better job. And I said, but Dad, that's what you did. It didn't work. And he says, yeah, but that's, you got to do that. And at that point, I decided to listen to my rich dad and go into the world of business. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a very simple story, starting at age 9 of my two dads. Like I said, my dad was a school teacher, well-educated, hardworking man. Whereas my rich dad was my best friend's father, and he was a man who started with nothing, but he ultimately became one of the richest guys in Hawaii. So when you look at the white sand beaches, the blue water, the palm trees, and the hula girls, these the big hotels in the background, Rich Dad owns some of the land under those hotels. So they estimate for 7 generations, none of his kids' kids will ever have to work again. It's not that not working is that big an ideal. It's just that it was, for me, amazing that one man could start with nothing and accumulate such wealth in a short period of time. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a very simple story of what two fathers tell their sons about money. And I wrote this book in 1997, published it. Everybody said, I submitted it around. People said, we don't want this book. Who are you? You can't write. You suck. And all that other stuff, you know. And what do you know about money? And so, excuse me, I'm still a Marine, you can tell here, you know. If I make those slips, forgive me, you know. But anyway, so I printed 1,000 copies of this book. Nobody bought it, so I shipped it to a friend's gas station in Austin, Texas. And I put the book in, he says, put it in the gas station. So we don't sell books in gas stations. I said, no, good, that's a good place for it. No competition, you know. And he says, if that silly book of yours doesn't sell, you get it back. I said, don't worry, I'll get it, take it back. And the book sat there for the 12, I think it's shipped on 12 or 18 of them. And they sat there for a whole week. And he called me up, he said, you're gonna get them back? None have sold. And I said, oh, well, just patience. And aside by the second week, all were gone. And that's how it started. It went by word of mouth. It's now in 38 different languages, 13 million copies, and it just kept going. So that was the story of how this book got started. Thank you. So I thank you all for who have read it and those who come to listen about it. Anyway, another thing that's magical about this book is that I flunked out of high school twice. And here's my dad, the superintendent of education. I flunked out of twice because I can't write, you know. And if my father wasn't superintendent of education, I might still be in high school today, you know. But very simply, the reason I got Fs was because I couldn't spell. You know, and I tried this on my two English teachers, the ones that flunked me. I said, you know, it's not a very creative person who cannot spell a word 3 or 4 different ways, you know. And they still said, you still get the F right out of here, you know, and all this. So I had to take summer school and make up my grades. So anyway, I'll go into what Rich Dad, Poor Dad's about. For those who haven't been there, for those who have seen it, please bear with me. But very simply, My rich dad began teaching me by drawing the simple diagram here. He said, if you want to be a rich person, you have to understand accounting, basic accounting here. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a book on accounting, of all things. I was talking to a banker the other day, and he says, what's the book about? He says, it's about accounting. And he was going, that's ridiculous. I said, Arthur Anderson's ridiculous right now. They're supposed to be accountants, you know, and all this. And I said, the issue with Arthur Anderson was people could not read a financial statement. And so it's not so much about accounting, but it's being accountable, accountability, personal accountability. So for those who haven't read it, it's income, expense, asset, and liability. And it's really simple. You know, started at age 9, started talking to me about all this. And then my rich dad said to me, the most important word in business, if you're going to be a rich person, you must be able to control, and this is the single most important word. What's the word? Cash flow. It's the single most important word you can know. So very simply, my rich dad said to me, oh, he's talking about assets and liabilities. And my poor dad always said, son, our house is an asset. And my rich dad said to me, see, your father may be smart and can read books, but he can't read a financial statement. He says, if your father could read financials, he would see that your house is not an asset. It's really a liability. And that's where the problem starts with everybody here. One of the problems is that most of us go through our lives buying liabilities we think are assets, and because we cannot read a financial. So very simply, because I was 9 years old, my rich dad said to me simply, assets put money in your pocket. So what do assets do? Put money in your pocket. That's all they do, whether you work or not. So basically, this is the cash flow pattern of an asset. So when I read a financial, I can see what real assets are, which liabilities are. The definition of a liability is liabilities take money from your pocket. So this is a cash flow pattern of a liability. It's not rocket science. So simply put, my rich dad said, the house we live in as a family is a liability because every month it takes money from our pocket. Whether we work or not, it flows out. Now I hear people saying, but what if I pay off my mortgage? It doesn't make any difference because it's still a liability, because if you think you actually own your real estate, I think you're in for a shock, because the person who really owns your real estate is the government. It's called property tax. If you just don't pay your property tax, they seize your house here. So at the same time, a house can be an asset if it simply puts money in your pocket. So as a young boy, I knew, starting around the age 10, 12, or 14, I knew I was going to be a rich person simply by understanding the difference between assets and liabilities.
Well, the reason most people work hard for money is survival. You know, I got to pay the bills, I got to put a roof over my head, food in my mouth. And that's why I've always found it really hypocritical when people say, well, money's not that important, money's not that important. Yet they go to work all their lives, and they work just to put food on the table. And I think what they've forgotten is the fear that they have of not having that steady paycheck. You know, ask somebody who's lost their job how important money is. And that's why I've always questioned why our school system doesn't teach us about money. Isn't managing money a life skill? Isn't that something we use every single day? I remember asking my teacher once when I was about 12 years old, I said, why don't we study money? She says, no, poetry is more important. I'm going, well, poetry hasn't made me rich so far. I've made a few guys rich, but it hasn't made me rich. I can't use it in the real world. She says, well, we don't discuss money. Money is evil. And so I think there's a lot of hypocrisy and denial on the subject of money. Money is essential for life today. If you don't have money, you don't live. Pure and simple, you don't live. So I think most people have this fear of not having enough money. They deny it. They don't admit they have that fear.
How many people have had a chance to read Cash Flow Quadrant? For those who haven't, I think this is my most important book for anybody out there looking to make changes in their lives. Because this book gave me a greater direction, where I was going to go, what I was going to do. And what the quadrant is about, for those who haven't read it, the quadrant is very simply about the four people found in business. So I would sit there with my rich dad, and he says, E stands for employees. S stands for self-employed or small business or specialist. B stands for big business, like Bill Gates or Michael Dell. And Forbes defines it as 500 employees or more. And I stands for investor. The point my rich dad made is all four of these quadrants attract four different kinds of people. They're not the same people. He says you can tell by the words, the vocabulary they use, whether they're employee, big business, self-employed, or investor. He says an employee will always, whether they're the president or janitor of the company, they will say the same words. And the words are, I'm looking for a safe, secure, what? Job with benefits. That's what they want. Now you meet S, a self-employed person. A lot of times when a person says, I'm going to quit my job and go out on my own, they go from E to S, and S stands for cycle land. You know what I mean? It's one of the hardest positions of all. You know, because your employees pick on you, the government picks on you, and you pick on you, you know, and all this. So you can always tell a self-employed person is because they always say the same thing. They say, if you want it done right, do it by yourself. That's why they do it on their own. Or their theme song is, nobody does it what? Better. Or the other thing they say is, I'm the best. Am I the best? You know, I go to my reflexologist who massages my foot. She's always going, am I the best? I say, yeah, you're the best. Oh, thank you very much, you know. This S also stands for satisfied. Oftentimes, self-employed people, most of these people, a lot of them make a lot less employees per hour. But they love what they do. They say, I just love what I do. I just love what I do. I just love what I do. I say, but you're going broke. Yeah, but I love what I do, you know. And a big business person, their theme is they're looking for a team. You know, they put a football team together. They want to look at the best players, best CFO, best CEO, best presidents, best sales. They're team players. These people believe in other people's time. They don't want to work hard because they want other people to work hard for them. An investor, everybody today has to be an investor, but a true investor, their words are, what's my return on investment, ROI. That's all they care about, okay? So, simply put, is then my poor dad always said, get a job, climb the ladder, you know, make your way to the top. I said, yeah. I don't want to do this. I want to get rich. And my mother would say, I know your father. Your father really, you know, he has the best intentions in mind, and he wants you to follow in his footsteps, become a school teacher. And so finally my mom said, you know, son, I know you want to get rich. She was a nurse, registered nurse. So she said, why don't you become a doctor? You know, become one of the smart guys over here, because these are the smart guys here. These are where the doctors and attorneys and accountants and the architects and the engineers come from. She says, you should become a doctor. And I said to my mom, there's only one problem with that. She says, what's that? You have to be smart. She says, you have a good point there, you know what I mean? She says, I don't think you can become a doctor. She says, yeah, I'm a C student. You know, I am a straight, I'm just like a C minus student. She goes, yeah, you'll never make it. So I went to my rich dad and I said, you know, I'm kind of in trouble. So he draws this diagram here. He says, you know, Robert, are you basically lazy? I said, yeah, real lazy. He says, are you fundamentally incompetent? I said, yeah, I can't do anything. He says, are you a C student? I said, yeah, I'm a C student. He says, good, you'll do well in business here. So, there's a saying in my book, these are the A students, these are the B students, and these are the C students here. And the saying my rich dad said to me a long time ago, he says, the A students work for the C students and the B students work for the government. So the reason the cash flow quadrant is so important is that we're going to be talking in a little while about the 401k, which I think is one of the riskiest of all investments. So I am a professional investor. The reason I know which quadrant I am is, again, by the most important word, the word is cash flow. So the reason I know I'm an investor is if I stop working, my cash flow comes from my investments here. Many people invest, but most people are not investors. The reason you know you're an investor is you can live from this quadrant here. So whether I work or not, my wife and I have about $1 million annually coming in from our investments, so we can stop working. We keep working because I sort of like this work here, things like this, you know. Thank you. The problem with the 401k is people are putting money in and they're not getting any back. So they're investing, but they're not what? Investors, because the cash is flowing out, not flowing in here. And that's the definition here. The reason this quadrant is important for those who are willing to make changes here is because if you're going to make a change, you may want to change from here to here, or here to here, or here to here. The message is, in the book, is that at the core, you're different people. These people value security, and that's why they want job security. These people value independence. These people value teamwork, and these people value laziness. They want to work. They want their money coming back here. So I'm going to ask to do something a little bit different, because I really personally did not like school. I graduated from the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy here at Kings Point. I have a Bachelor of Science degree, which stands for BS. And other than that, but I really didn't like school simply because I wasn't learning what I wanted. I remember that I said, why am I studying poetry? I said, because it makes you a better human being. I said, why not study money? Make me a better human being. And they wouldn't talk to me. The other thing I didn't like about school was that every time at test time, I wanted to cooperate. You know? And what did the teacher call cooperation at test time? Cheating, you know? And yet, that's the world of the school. See, these guys here, they're the good students here. They don't cheat. They do things on their own. These guys are a bunch of, they cheat over here. And you're going to find out tonight how true that is. The rules are different for all four people. The tax laws are different for all four people. The rules are different, big part of it here. So one of the things I learned, if I wanted to be a business owner, I needed to talk, I needed to communicate, I needed to have other people around me. So I'm going to be doing something different. One of the things that my rich dad taught me, he says, the reason your poor dad is poor is that he takes tests on his own. So he says, you know, every day we have money problems. We all have money problems. If you're rich, you have money problems. If you're poor, you have money problems. The difference is how we handle our money problems. And my poor dad handled his money problems by sitting there all by himself, talking to no one, because he would be cheating if he talked. I'm the man of the house, leave me alone. I said, yeah, but Dad, you're an idiot. You don't know anything about this. Well, leave me alone here. And just because you're a man doesn't mean you know anything about money, you know. Most women know that, but they don't tell the guy that. And my rich dad did it differently. He cooperated. He sat around with his banker, his accountants, his attorneys, his real estate brokers, his financial planners, you know, his insurance agents, and they would talk. And twice a month, I saw him do it. He would sit, he owned several restaurants. He would sit at his restaurant table, buy a lunch for all of his advisors, and he sat down and he showed him his financial statements. And he says, tell me what I'm doing. And he got the help of some of the brightest minds around. In other words, my rich dad, being a C student, got help from the A students here. And he sat there, and that's where he got his education from. He said, I got the best education of all because I surrounded myself with smart people. But my poor dad said that was what? Cheating. And he did it all on his own here. So tonight I'm going to ask you to cooperate or cheat the way you look at it. In a little while I'm going to ask you to talk amongst yourselves. I'm going to ask you a very simple question. What did your mommy and daddy tell you? You know, it'd be this, this, this. Did they talk to you about money here like this? And did your mommy and daddy, were they poor people, middle class people, or rich people by their cash flow patterns? That's the question. So I want to ask you to talk amongst yourself because today there's so many people in here that I don't have time to answer questions. And so by talking amongst yourself, if you have a question, the person sitting next to you, you can help them. Say, well, the idiot said this about this thing, you know, and I don't agree with him, but this is what he did. So you can help each other out. You talk, you can clarify. But the important part, we're starting simple right now. At the second half of tonight, we're going to go into much more complex financial things. And you're going to need help. If you sit there by yourself, you may miss some very important points. Two minds are better than what? One, except in school. It's absolutely ridiculous. So being a C student, I surround myself with the smartest people I can find. So I'm going to give you 30 seconds. Every so often, I'll give you this 30-second break. You can talk amongst yourselves and all this. It brings your energy up. You can take a break. I can cheat my notes, look at what I'm going to say next, and things like this, okay? So turn to somebody next to you and talk for about 30 seconds. What did your mom and daddy say about money? Were they rich, poor, middle class? And which quadrant are you in? ES, B, and I. Ready, go.
So I remember as a kid, my mother would go to the shoyu factory, the soy sauce factory, where they made tofu. And this is growing up in Hawaii, it's a little sugar plantation town. And the way my mother tried to save money was by feeding us cheap food. And we had money, but she was cheap. And she always wanted to save and save and save, so she would go and buy the waste product. In other words, after they made the soy sauce and after they made the tofu, there was this byproduct. That's what they sell in health food stores now is health food, but in those days, just threw it away. So my mother was actually making us healthy by eating cheap food, but I just still remember the whole mentality of our family was poor. Even though we made more money than most families, the mentality was poor. There was always this fear of never having enough money. And so that's why, you know, a lot of times I think that it really affected my thoughts as a kid, and I wondered why we had to live in such fear of not having enough money. It didn't make sense to me. Now, my dad was a great teacher. Like I said, you know, he was a straight-A student, but he never expected his children to be. I don't think any of the children were really academically bright. And my dad always knew that each kid is a different gift. So even though I flunked out of high school twice, and my father was the boss, he never really got upset with me. You know, he just said, you'll find your own thing later on in life. But little did I know that I'd already found what I was looking for, starting at the age of 9, by having my rich dad, who was my best friend's father, start to teach me. And I always wondered why people were poor. It didn't make sense to me, or why people lived in fear of money. It made no sense, or why you had to work so hard for it. So that's why I was, as a kid, starting at age 9, I started looking for some answers.
Thank you. Good. Some of you are getting into it. That's good. Some of you, I can still tell the A students, I said, I'm not going to talk to anybody. I'm going to do it on my own. Okay. How many people had a chance to read Prophecy in this room? Good. Thank you. I wrote this book. It's called Rich Dad's Prophecy. It's why the biggest stock market crash in history is still coming. The reason I wrote Prophecy is because what's really been concerning me is in 1974, President Gerald Ford signed into law what was called ERISA, Employee Retirement Income Security Act. So he signed it into law. Today we know it as the 401k. What was really disturbing me, and the reason I wrote these books, was that law in 1974 was a shift from a defined benefit pension plan to a defined contribution, i.e. 401k. In Australia, they're called superannuations. The world follows America. Japan started one back in 2000, I think. They call it a 401k. In Canada, I think it's called an RRSP, and in Singapore, it's called a CPF. And basically what the shift was, and the reason I'm concerned, was a defined benefit plan was this. I call the World War II generation plan. If my mother and father, they went to work, they didn't have to worry about their retirement because they had a defined benefit plan. And the defined benefit defined how much they made. So my dad, if he retired, he said, let's say they say you get $1,000 a month adjusted for inflation for as long as you live. The problem was people started living longer. And the major corporations could not afford a defined benefit plan anymore. So the retirement was very expensive. Like we just saw recently, General Motors, their defined benefit plan is underfunded by some 20-something billion dollars, something billion dollars. You gotta sell a lot of cars to make up $27 billion. But the other thing a defined benefit plan had, it had medical. You see, so my mom and dad never had to worry about medical because a defined benefit plan covered it. A defined contribution does not. Okay, and that is why I was concerned. And basically, it was the big corporations saying to the employees, you are now responsible for your retirement. If you live to 120, good luck. You know, all the best to you. Bon voyage. But the difference was a defined contribution. A major difference is the money could run out. By definition, the contribution was only what you contributed, if you contributed, and what your employer contributed. So let's say you're 85 years old and you run out of money, it's sayonara. We don't have to worry about you anymore. Now, you can always get a job. McDonald's is always hiring. You know, there's no problem there. But you don't want to be 85 years old and out of money. So that's what really spurred me. I said, I should write this book because I knew certain things. So the big flaw in the defined contribution is you can run out of money. The second thing, there's no medical attached to it. I hear financial planners say, don't worry, when you get older, your living expenses go down. What they don't tell you is your medical goes up. And so people can be hung out to dry at 85 or 65, whatever the case may be. And the other part about it is if the market crashes due to volatility, you can get wiped out here. This people, my mom and dad, didn't have to worry about market volatility very simply because it was not their problem. It was the company's problem. Also in this thing, the flaw in this law, which I write about here in Prophecy, was the Internal Revenue Service wanted their pound of flesh. So the Internal Revenue Service built into the 401k in America a statement that says you must withdraw when you hit 70 because they want their money what? Back. Because you put it in tax-free, they want their pound of flesh. So they said, we're going to take the money back. In the year 2016, the first of 83 million baby boomers turns 70.
At that point, they must exercise. They have to start withdrawing because the government wants their money back. And people are saying, well, do you think the government will forgive that? I said, I doubt it. You know, they're going to probably increase it, not decrease it here. But the point here is this. My prediction is, I'm concerned, is sometime in the near future, 5, 10, 15 years from now, when other people find out, who are putting money in their 401k, they find out that the baby boomers are exiting out the back, they're going to say, what's wrong with this? And there's going to be possibly a panic. And they're going to start pulling their money out because nobody wants to be the last guy to turn out the lights. Does that make sense, you guys, here? So would you take about 15 seconds and discuss with the person sitting next to you? I call this a World War II plan, and this is a Vietnam-era plan. Take a moment to discuss some of the strengths and weaknesses of both plans for about 15 seconds, and then we'll move on, okay? Thank you.
Now, most people focus on how hard they can work for money. You know, what can I do? My career, I can climb the corporate ladder. So they're focusing on working for money. But to have money work for you requires financial intelligence. Financial intelligence is defined as not how much money you make, but how much money you keep, how long that money works for you, how hard it works for you, and how many generations can you pass it forward to. So most people don't have that because they just focus on going to work and making money, but they never have financial intelligence. When I was having trouble in school, and I was having Fs, you know, my mother went hysterical, my father went a little bit upset. Even my rich dad said to me, he says, shape up and get your grades up, because you have to. But he says, I'll tell you a big, very big secret. And the big secret was this, my banker has never once asked me for my report card yet. You know, my banker doesn't care what grades I have. My banker doesn't care what college I went to. My banker wants to see one thing, is how smart I am with my money. And if I'm smart with my money, my banker will give me more money. If I'm an idiot with my money, the banker will turn you down and say, I don't want to lend you the money. So financial intelligence is what your banker looks for. Your school teacher looks for academic intelligence, and they're two different things.
Please begin finishing up. And stop. Thank you, partners. Okay, moving on. Thank you for talking and clearing anything up somebody doesn't understand. Really simply, when you look at a financial statement of a World War II person, era person, what they had in here was a defined benefit plan. They had social securities, and most of them had savings. See, one of the things the World War II generation did not have was they didn't have credit cards. And the introduction of credit cards has decimated the savings and all this stuff of the younger generation is coming along. And our school system is not yet caught up with the fact that people are in debt up to their eyeballs. I mean, the school debt, medical debt, living debt, people are in debt up to their eyeballs right now. But the trouble is they don't have this. And the thing I hear people saying to me, well, don't worry, especially the politicians, Social Security will save you. And as my Chinese friends, they go, Social Security, you know? It really is Social Security here. So the good news is the World War II generation's in good shape, but they passed the problem on to us. So I'll show you this demonstration over here. I think this is 12. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. This is 12 books here. Back in 1950, what date is this? 1950. This is what it looked like for the World War II generation. They had 11 workers for every one recipient of Social Security. So they didn't have to worry because it wasn't that expensive, you know. So they got the money and all this stuff. Plus they had Medicare, Medicaid, thanks to Johnson and all those guys. There was one more thing the World War II generation had. They had Social Security, but they also had a defined benefit pension plan. So this person here was in really good shape. They had the rest of the workers to take care of them, the younger guys. And they had the defined benefit pension plan. So that's what it looks like. Then what happened is by the year 2000, it had gone to this here. So this is what it looks like today. Okay. So there's 9 to 3. There's 9 workers for every 3 recipients. Now, I want to show you what the year 2025 is going to look like. The year 2025 is going to look like this. You're going to have 1 recipient for every 2 workers here. That means Social Security tax for this to have the same benefits as this, has to go up by 25%. They have to increase Social Security tax on the workers here. The thing I'm going to find out in the second half is the rich don't pay the Social Security tax. The workers do. It is really, really rotten here. So I'll show you again. This is 1950. This is the future, 2025. And there's one more thing. These guys, if this is defined benefit pension plan, these guys don't have it. And that's why I wrote Prophecy. We have a financial dilemma coming up here in just 25 years. And every time I hear a politician say, don't worry, I shall save Social Security, I said, you must be a magician. So anyway, would you take a moment to discuss why I personally, how many people in this room are not going to count on Social Security? You know what I mean? Good. So would you please take a moment and discuss what's going on here and some possible solutions? The only solution I can see is raise taxes. And I'll say it one more time, the rich don't pay this tax. And I'll explain the second half. So please discuss that really quickly. Most people are not interested in becoming rich. Most people just don't want to lose. And that's why they lose. You know, it's just really a tragic. I want to play it safe. I don't want to take risk. You know, let somebody else invest my money for me. I say it again, people turn their money over to these mutual fund managers. That's the stupidest thing you can do because you don't learn anything. You know, the fund manager gets your money and they get all the experience, but you get nothing. All you do is get an empty 401k statement. So if you're going to become a great investor, you're the one who has to start the investing. If you want to turn it over to somebody you hope is smarter than you, good luck.
Please begin finishing up. And stop. Thank you, partners. Okay, moving on. In the 19th century, there was a French philosopher named Auguste Comte, C-O-M-T-E. And he said this. Demography is what? Destiny. In other words, how can I predict the future? And the way I can predict the future is look at the demographics. It's really that simple. What's really going on with the population as they age and move along? Some people say, excuse my artwork, I didn't. This is a snake. They call it the pig and the python. Okay? And this little pig over here is called the baby boom generation. There was this big boom because Johnny came marching home from war and they had sex. They had a great time over here. So a few years ago, it was initially, this 1946 to 64. At the start, there was 75 million baby boomers, but due to in-migration, it's now up to 83 million in this category. So it's going through the python like this big thing. So this caused the boom in housing prices, you know, consumer goods, credit cards hit them, and all this stuff. So the problem is, when you look at this thing, if you look at the stock market went up in 1980. It started going up because the baby boomers, due to a 401k, again, signed into the law in 1974, they started to come in. Now, the same thing that caused the boom, which we just fell through in 2000, is that pretty soon, in 2016, by law, they will exit. Okay, and that's sort of the problem. Now, the problem is not big of a deal because there's more kids coming along and all this, but they may not be as stupid as we are, you know, to put up with this stuff here. So this is the thing. And the problem with a big 401k, and I look at it as a professional investor, is the problem with it, we all know this, except the guys who wrote the law. The problem with a 401k is it never took in market forces. And with all markets, markets go up. This is called a bull market. So all markets move in three directions. How many directions? Three. This is number one. It's called a bull. When the market moves down, it's called a what? Bear. Three directions. In the next direction, it goes sideways, and that's called a channel market. Okay, very simple here. Now, as a professional investor, I love bull markets. What they say is the bull comes up by the stairs and the bear goes out the window. And what that means, the bull market comes up very, very slowly. And then this time it was year 2000. When it hit, it dropped like a rock. That's the problem with bulls and bears. The reason I can predict a stock market crash is because this. I will guarantee you markets always go in three directions. Markets always go up, markets always go down, and markets always go sideways. As a kid, I used to surf. This is a wave here. Every year, waves come up and waves come down. It's economic cycles. I will guarantee you there's going to be a crash. I'll also guarantee you there will be a boom. It's market cycles. Predicting a crash is no big deal. Absolutely no big deal. Anybody can do it because it's part of economic cycle. Predicting a crash is like predicting winter in Nova Scotia, hurricanes in Florida, tornadoes in Texas. Those are part of weather cycles, while booms and busts are part of economic cycles. Now, the fallacy in the 401k, it was written by lawmakers and things like this, people who are not professional investors, people not from the I quadrant. So a 401k does exceptionally well here. Okay, it does well in a bull market. It does horrible in a bear market. So what happens is they say, well, on average, don't worry, market goes up. That's true, but it comes down so quickly that, you know, the average investor in the last, from 2000 to 2002, lost 35% of their value in just 2 years. Something that took 20 years to accumulate was wiped out in 2 years. And the fallacy is they don't think these bear markets exist. The Enron guys, they got wiped out, and some of them got wiped out entirely. There was one guy who took early retirement. He's now 68 years old. When he retired, prior to the Enron crash, he had $2.2 million in his 401k. After the Enron crash 1 year ago, it's now down to $6,500. So he wrote into one of these famous financial planning magazines, I won't mention his name, to ask him for his advice. They said, invest for the long term. This guy is out of time. He's out of time. They said, no, buy and hold, invest for the long term, market will come back. What they don't tell you is when the market goes into a sideways channel, it may stay down for 10 to 20 years. After the stock market crash in 1929, it took 25 years to come back to zero again. That's how long it can stay down. And the lawmakers who wrote this law did not take into account crashes. There's also something, the reason I can predict a crash is this. Inside this law, you know, it goes up like this, but what the 401k does, it handcuffs you. If you take your money out early, what happens? You're penalized. You cannot get out of this. They'll be like me, I was a helicopter pilot, you know, that's like riding the old airplane up. It goes over the top, it goes shoosh. And what that looks like is this. Here's a little 401k person. Oh, this is good, I'm putting my $100 a month in. And the market is going up, going up. Oh, this is so wonderful, I must be intelligent, you know. You know, when the Dow hit 12,000, people thought it was their IQ. You know what I mean? They go, and I'll tell you, as a professional investor, what causes a boom is amateurs piling into the market. So they saw their 401ks going up. They thought they were intelligent. They thought they were investors. They put their savings into it. And that's what the savings went down to negative. People poured their money in, and suddenly the market turns down. It goes like this. I'm sorry. If you take your money out, I'll penalize you. Go back to the, don't worry, invest for the long term. Okay.
I can't get out, I can't get out.
Don't worry, the market comes back on average. Am I right? The stupid law handcuffed you to the airplane. Professional investors don't like handcuffs to the airplane. You know, they want a parachute, not handcuffs. And the law handcuffs you. So today I see people, this is your 401k, say, oh no, no. Oh. I'll just pretend it's okay. Psychiatrists call that denial, you know? So, would you take a moment right now and discuss the insanity of handcuffing people to an airplane? 30 seconds, discuss the insanity of that.
I think one of the things that we develop as we grow older is our emotional intelligence. We all have fear, we all have doubts, we all have lack of self-confidence. The difference is most people, a lot of people run away from the fear. And what I was taught to do by my dads, both my rich dad and my poor dad, was to learn to overcome my fears, because we all have fears, but we shouldn't let fear run our lives. In the Marine Corps, I learned to overcome my fear because, you know, we flew dangerous missions, and the night before every mission, you had to make peace with yourself, because if I didn't fly well, not only did I die, but my crew members died. And so I had to make peace with my soul and overcome my fear of dying. There's one guy who said, oh, I'm afraid tomorrow I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die. And I would say to him, it says, your job description says kill people, not die. Because what really destroys people, not only in war, but in life and in money, is fear. And if we never learn to overcome our fears, that's why people are not successful. And so when I came back from Vietnam, my rich dad said to me, if you're gonna be a business owner, the number one skill you have to have is you have to be able to sell. Whether it's you're selling your products, you're asking investors for money. And my problem was I came back from Vietnam and I could kill people, but I couldn't sell them anything. And so I'd overcome my fear of having people shoot at me. But now the new fear was, how do you go and, you know, knock on the door and say, hi, I'm here to sell you something. And the fear of rejection is one of the greatest fears all of us have. And that's why I went to work for the Xerox Corporation when I came back from Vietnam, was to overcome my fear of knocking on the door and the fear of being rejected.
Please begin finishing up. And stop. Thank you, partners. So a couple more points, okay? This thing comes down here. What did all these people shift their, because the mutual funds allow you to shift your money. They now shifted into bonds down here at the bottom, getting what, 2% short term, maybe 5% 30 year. That's ridiculous. You see, buying a bond at the bottom is just as insane as buying high tech at the top. You should have been buying bonds when they were paying 7% and not buying it when it's 2%. You ass backwards, in the scientific term here. But don't worry, don't worry. Human nature, well, you know what's good about human beings? They have short memories. And maybe around 2004, 2005, you know, it'll chug along here for another couple of years, and then it'll go chick, 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 chick. And maybe till 2008, then all the people who forget will climb back in, they think their IQ went up again, and then it'll go, yahoo! And then it'll be, So don't worry, there's another boom coming, but there's also another what? Bust. I guarantee it. Because it's part of economic cycle. It has happened throughout history. Another piece of good news is this, is that the studies have shown for the last 300 or 400 years, if a person lived to 75 years of age, he went through 2 recessions and 1 depression. Okay. So my parents, the WW2 generation, the good thing for them is they went through their depression early in life, right? The Vietnam era generation, they're gonna go through it late in life, because if it happens approximately every 75 years, let's see, the last depression was 72 years ago. And so that's what the good news here is, the rich will get richer and the rest will be depressed. You know, they say, a recession is when your neighbor loses his job, and a depression is when you lose yours. Excuse my laughter, but I am sick individual here. And I'll tell you why I'm a sick individual, because if I could use a scientific term, every time I talk to what is considered the average investor, or a stockbroker, or a financial planner, or some disbeliever in the whole thing. You know, somebody who's under 30 years old and has not yet done the ride. You know, they always say, well, on average, the market goes up. I said, yeah, it goes up on average, but averages are for average investors. I would never take an average, never. Professionals cannot take averages. The last 2 years, I said the average investor lost 35%. Some lost everything. That's why you don't want to be an average investor here. Sometimes I take an average, but I can't afford to. So rather than get into, and by the way, my rich dad said, if you want to be successful, be careful who you take financial advice from. Most people take financial advice from their brother-in-law, who's an idiot, and they wonder why they're in trouble, you know what I mean?
or somebody, a co-worker in the lunchroom eating a bologna sandwich telling you how to get rich. You know, this is really ridiculous here. I mean, that's and then the best part about it, you know, you take advice from stockbrokers, financial brokers, real estate brokers, insurance brokers. My rich dad said the reason they call them brokers is because they're broker than you are, you know? I love my stockbroker, I love my real estate broker, I love my insurance broker, but ultimately it's my brain and I'm careful what advice I put in here. Is that clear to you guys here? So I get into these arguments, you know, I was on the phone call, this guy says, well, you know, this will never happen because the Asians will be coming into the U.S. stock market, so it will not dampen the effect of this. You know, as the baby boomers exit, the Asians who are dummies will come in here. And the South Americans and the Mexicans, they're going to jump in here. So that's good. Good news here. You know, well, what they say is, on average, the transition in 2016 will be a peaceful one. Oh, that's good. Okay. So that's the standard line of BS, blue sky, they hand out here. Professional investors cannot take that advice. So I'm going to give you, I think, four tips tonight of how a professional investor looks at this here. Okay? And rather than get into, like I said, the scientific term, a pissing match with all those guys, I'll just tell you how I look at it. Excuse me, I'm still a Marine, but I sit there and argue with people. My rich dad said, if you argue with an idiot, there's now two idiots. You know what I mean? So, I'm going to give you a point of view of professional investors versus average investors. And point number one, there's a lot of them, but this is the main one. Professional investors know markets go up and down. Okay? Professional investors do not care if markets go up and down, simply because a professional investor will make money going up as well as coming what? Down. They don't care. When I say there's a market crash, and I hear, people start hyperventilating on me and, you know, seeing Aztec temples or something, whatever they see. You know, I know they're an average investor because they've taken a position that the market has to go up. A pro doesn't care what's up. Another thing, too, is the rule of a professional trader is don't take a position. I never say the market's going to go up or down. I don't really care. Because the moment you say it's going to go up, then you have to psychologically be right. I want to prove I'm right. And that's when you get stuck. So pros never take a position. Is it going to go up and down? So I don't care. See? Average investors care, pros don't care. That is a very big difference, because I can make it in all directions there. Please discuss that really quickly, 15 seconds. More than personal responsibility, people need to change their attitudes. My poor dad always said to me, go to school and get a job with the government, because the government had good benefits, good pension, good medical. And I think there's too many people out there with that same attitude as my poor dad. They expect the government to take care of them, the company to take care of them, the boss to take care of them, their fund manager to take care of them. You look at the President of the United States, he gets a huge pension and all that. The government takes care of him. I think in the world today, and especially in America, we have too many people that take care of me attitude. And it's not just the people on welfare. There's a lot of people in government and service and all this who take government jobs or big corporations jobs expecting people to take care of them. It starts with a change of responsibility. I don't want anybody to take care of me. I'll take care of myself. Please begin finishing up. And stop. Thank you, partners. Okay. The worst thing about a 401k, it works well when it goes up, doesn't work well when it comes what? Down. And if you actually believe that stock markets always go up, you know, and that 401ks will there be protecting you, then you're probably a big Harry Potter fan. You know what I mean? And you haven't quite grown up yet to look at the reality of markets going up and down. So I would never have a strategy, a single strategy that only goes up. You got to have at least three strategies, one for up, one for down, one for sideways. The second point is this. I invest like my banker, okay? When I look at investing, I look at the jaundiced point of view of a banker. Not that bankers are rich. Some of the worst people I know are bankers as far as investors go. But they have certain good traits. They have certain things you look at. For example, if I went to my banker and I asked my banker, would you loan me $1 million to put in my 401k so I can retire? What's the banker going to say to you? No. It's too risky. And yet the government puts everybody into a 401k, something a banker would not lend you money on. Ask your banker this: would you lend me money to buy mutual funds? Answer again is no. Okay, no, because they're too risky. Now, if I go to my banker and I say to my banker, will you lend me money to buy real estate? Generally, they say what? Yes, at least they'll look at it. They'll come talk to you, but they won't talk to you for 401k or mutual funds. That is absolutely ridiculous. So one of the reasons I get richer quicker is very simply, I don't use my money. You know, the middle class, like I said, they have different values. They believe in saving money and getting out of debt. The rich don't believe that. They say borrow. Because what you have to know, there's good debt and there's what? Bad debt. The middle class is stuck in bad debt. The rich have good debt. When somebody says it's good to save money and get out of debt, I say this to them. I said, how long, right now, my wife and I are closing on a property this week, $8 million, almost 100% financed. I asked the people, I said, how long would it take you to save $8 million? How long would it take you to save $8 million? You know, for most people, they can't do it. They can pay $8 million in taxes, but they can't save $8 million, you know. It takes me 2 weeks to borrow $8 million. On top of that, because it's good debt, every month it puts a minimum of $50,000 in my pocket. Every month, bonk, bonk, bonk. So I get ahead faster by using my banker's what? Money, while the middle class is trying to get out of debt and save money, okay? The next point is this, point three. A professional investor will never invest without insurance. See, when you look at insurance here, you know, the trouble with the 401k, there's no insurance on it. When I go to my banker and I say, I want to borrow, I want to buy a piece of real estate, the banker requires me to have what? Insurance. They require me to have it, okay? Now, a couple of years ago, I had an apartment house burned down. Thank God nobody was hurt. Now, was I upset? Yes, but I wasn't wiped out financially, very simply because the insurance company replaced it. In fact, they gave me a better apartment house because it was new. And they paid all my back rent I didn't get and all that. So I invest with insurance. The same thing in the stock market as in real estate, a professional investor, when the market goes up like this, they'll invest with insurance. I'll give you an example really quickly. Let's say the stock is at $50 and the investor senses the trend's about to change down. What they might do is put in what's called a trailing stop. Now, if you don't want to put a stop in, what you can do is you can buy a put here. And very simply, a put is insurance. That in case the stock, let's say, plummets on down to, let's say, $10 here, what the put allows you to do, it may cost you $2. What the put allows you to do is still sell your stock at $50, so you don't lose any money. The more you understand puts and calls or options, the less I'll buy stock anyway, because puts and calls are less expensive and higher returns. The trouble is you need to spend about 3 or 4 years studying this stuff. So today when I buy a stock, I'll buy a put. The scientific word in my market is called a hedge. Hedge is insurance. Look, we don't drive our cars without insurance. We don't buy houses without insurance. But the 401k asks us to invest without what? Insurance for our future. It makes no sense to me as a professional investor. Take 30 seconds to discuss that. When people say, I don't have time to invest, I know they don't really think like an investor. I'm investing in my head. I mean, so I can be talking right now to this camera, but in my head, I'm still doing a deal. I mean, right now, I am putting two deals together, one to sell, one to buy. So most of the time, I'm in my head. Investing takes no physical time. Investing takes mental time. The other message I have for people is this. If you want to become a good investor, you have to start off a bad investor. If you want to be a good golfer, you start off a bad golfer. And unfortunately, most people are not willing to go through the part of being a bad investor so they can become a good investor. My wealth today doesn't really come from what I buy. My wealth really comes from who I became in the process of making so many mistakes. You know, our maker, God, Allah, Muhammad, Buddha, designed us to learn by making mistakes. And unfortunately, our school system teaches people not to make mistakes. And so they don't make mistakes. And if you don't make mistakes, you don't become good. And that's a tragedy. Please begin finishing up. And stop. Thank you, partners. So let me ask you this. people who invest in 401ks and all this, put their money in 401ks, what kind of insurance do they tell you to do? What do they tell you to do to protect yourself from crashes? Diversify. I call it de-worsify. I mean, spread your risk so thin you don't get any gains in it. I'll say this much. Professionals insure or protect. Average investors diversify. It is not a good strategy from a professional point of view. Now, I want to say one thing. I'm not saying get out of your 401k. I am not saying that. It's still, for the average person, it's still the best. That's all you got. So if you want to become a professional investor, there's a thing called education that needs to be done. If you're not willing to get educated, diversify, invest for the long term, buy, hold, and pray, and read Harry Potter books. You'll be fine. You know what I mean? You believe in the magic kingdom here. Warren Buffett says this about diversification. He says, diversification is a protection against ignorance. You do not have to do it if you know what you're doing. So please hear me. Don't get out of your 401k unless you're willing to get what? Educated, okay? Very important point. So now the fourth point I'll bring up, and then this is between a professional investor, an average investor. It's called a money-back guarantee. Whenever I hear a financial planner tell me, he says, don't worry, the Asians are going to come in, the South Americans and the Mexicans, they're going to prop up this market. You don't have to worry about that crash in 2016. The first thing I ask that guy is this, will you guarantee it? And generally they say what? No. They say, well, the market always goes up. I say, will you guarantee it? The answer is what? No. They will not guarantee it. So that anyway you want to detect BS or blue sky, just ask them for a guarantee. Ask them if they'll give you your money back. And if they don't, you know it's blue sky. Look, when I go to Sears, I don't like the product, they what? Give me my money back. So a professional investor always asks for a money back guarantee. Going back to your banker asks you for a money back guarantee. It's called a mortgage. In other words, the banker doesn't give you a mortgage, you give the bank a mortgage. And it's securitized by a piece of property. And what they do is, let's say the thing is $100,000, they'll do an LTV, a loan to value. So it's worth $100,000 at appraisal, they'll give you $80,000 for it. But the mortgage says, if you mismanage it, we want our money back. They take the property back and they sell it in what's called a foreclosure. So the problem I have with the 401k is they don't give you a what? Money back guarantee. No insurance, your banker won't touch it, and it's not good for an up and down market. 30 seconds, discuss that really quickly.
So a lot of people have this idea you have to go to college to be rich, and you know going to college is okay, but you don't learn anything about getting rich in college. And my rich dad oftentimes said to me, he says, if going to school made you rich, then school teachers would be millionaires. So going to school doesn't make you rich. It's what you learn after school that makes you rich. And in fact, what I say to most people is that if you want to get rich, you don't get rich at work, you get rich at part-time. You know, what are you doing in your spare time? And most people are kind of wasting their spare time. Look at the number of people like Michael Dell, founder of Dell Computers, richest man under 40. He started Dell Computers in his dorm room when he should have been studying. Henry Ford started Ford Motor Company in his garage. Hewlett Packard started in a garage. And most multimillionaires didn't get rich at work, they got rich in their spare time. It's what they did after school or after work that makes you rich.
And stop. Thank you, partners. So ladies and gentlemen, I'm not blaming this problem on Wall Street, the stock market, or that. I think the problem of this fiasco right now is found in this word here, education. Our school system is still in the dark ages. It can barely teach people to read and write now, much less teach anything about money. And I think it's going to cause a lot of pain and heartache. Man, they didn't pick up on the credit card, they sure didn't pick up on the 401k. So today our educators, you know, in America, there's three kinds of education that's pretty good. One is academic. America's not doing that good a job on it, but it's okay. You know, but if you do well in academic, they consider you a genius and A students and all that stuff. The second type of education is professional. And I say where America excels in professional education, whether you become a doctor or a lawyer, an electrician, a computer programmer, professional education. But where the school system failing right now is providing no financial education. And that's going to be the demise of this country, because we have a bunch of people who are not, they don't have the life skills to handle life. If you're going to be successful today, you need all three types of education, not just two. The difference is my poor dad thought this was important, and my rich dad thought this was important. That was the big difference. So before I go any further, I'm going to give you an example right now what financial education looks like. Because you don't have to go to Harvard, you don't have to go to Wharton, you don't have to go to Stanford. You don't need to be an A student to get a financial education. My rich dad taught me most of it just playing Monopoly. Four greenhouses, one red hotel. It's not that hard. You know, the reason I created this cash flow game over here is very simply to make it fun and easy. The big part of the cash flow game here is a financial statement. So you learn two principles here. You learn to be an accountant. You're not being an accountant, but you learn the principles of accounting. But also you learn the four levels of investing. Over here is the rat race. This is what, when you say to a child, go to school and get a job, you sentence them to the rat race here, you know. So this is one level of investing. These people are stock pickers or mutual fund buyers right in here. The next level is a small deal. And this is when you buy a small duplex or something like this. Next come the bigger deals, when you start buying maybe 12 plexes, 25 units and all this. The fast track out here really exists. This is where the SEC says you must be an accredited investor. 1933 law, you must be a millionaire. This is where the best investments are found. This is where the rich invest. And the fourth level of investing is found in this one here. It's called Cashflow 202. You need this board game to play this. And Cashflow 202 goes into day trading and options. The problem with most people doing day trading and options, they don't know this part about it here. They don't know this part about it here. Does that make sense, you guys, here? So I just made it fun. That's the kind of education. The thing I'm happy about right now is I'll bring up several people for you to meet. They work for my company. And I'll be talking about the kind of education our company provides for our workers. Because we have a 401k plan, but we tell all of our workers, we don't want you to hang around. We want you to get out of the rat race. One person I want to bring up here is one of the people who works with us as a staff member. She was actually our first staff person. It was Kim, Sharon, and I, and we brought, because Cecilia came up here, we hired her as a temporary staff person. And I was going to talk about what our company does is we encourage, this is half of Cecilia, please. This is the real boss. I mean, she tells me what to do every single day. But anyway, we encourage everybody to leave our company, don't you?
We absolutely do.
And what we do as far as education goes, we shut down the company half day, one day a month. The whole company sits there. They play the cash flow game. They invite their friends and all this. And I'm really proud because we have to walk our talk. You know, we have to, if we say to do this, get out of this rat race. And she was the first staff member, and she's the first staff member who can now quit her work for us. Right? You're out of the rat race.
I'm out of the rat race.
And what? So tell them how you did it.
Well, I've been with the company 4 years, and I've been sitting in that back room of the seminars and listening and listening and listening because I get to go to the seminars. And I finally went home and told my husband, George, I can't keep coming back there and walking away empty. I'm listening to this, I'm all gung-ho, but I get home and I just freeze. I'm like, I'm too afraid, I'm too conservative, I can't do this. And so we finally last year decided we've got to do something, because my husband's a lot older than I am, he's in his 50s. Even though we were high school sweethearts. And we always thought by now we'd be able to retire, I mean completely retire. And we have not been able to. And even though our children are grown and we've done everything the right way, the way we were taught to do it. So now Robert's teaching me how to do it his way. It's a lot better.
Yeah. So what did you buy? I mean, look, there's a million ways. You don't have to do it my way or this way. There's a million. This mind is unlimited if you open it up to potential. That's what the game designed to do, open it up to potential. So how was your way of retiring early?
Well, we looked at franchises and we looked at a lot of companies. We took almost 8 months of
Market research.
And we ended up buying a laundromat because it was something that it could run itself while I'm over there taking care of Robert. But eventually, as we get older, we hope to buy three this year. Because once we got the paperwork and we sat with it and we spread it out, in a couple of years, I can totally retire if I want to. Actually, I could retire today if I want to, but I just like a few more nicer things. But financially, I could retire right now.
Yeah, that one laundromat made more than what we were paying you, right? Which doesn't speak highly of what we pay, but no, it has benefits, yeah.
I wasn't going to bring that up, right? But we might talk about that later. Yeah.
And you can leave our company, but you choose to stay, right?
Oh, yeah. I learn so much every day. Not only were they helpful answering my questions, but just that the atmosphere, the people, you come home every day questioning again, okay, what more can I do? I'm hyped up again.
Yeah, good.
And that's really important.
Good. Give her a hand. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next person I want to bring up is the most important person in my life, and that's my wife, Kim.
Yeah.
And thank you. She was one of the first, she and I were homeless back in 85. We had no money. People kept saying, why don't you get a job? And the reason we didn't get a job was because we were going from here, to here, but we didn't want to go backwards. And she was the first woman that ever put up with me, who understood me, who was willing to fall down with me and stand up with me. So I'm here because of her. So with that, I bring my wife, Kim, out here, please.
Thank you.
There's so much passion in the sister thing. But I know she didn't marry me for my money because I didn't have any.
That's true.
She wants to talk to, her passion is talking to women about investing, right?
Yes, I love to encourage women in the game of investing. And what I found is women need to invest for different reasons. And I came across some statistics recently that were pretty surprising. 47% of women over the age of 50 are single, meaning that they're responsible for their own finances. And many of us know that 50% of marriages end in divorce. And then who usually gets the kids? Women. So they're now responsible for themselves and their kids. And on top of it, the first year after a divorce, a woman's standard of living drops 74%. That's huge. And finally, I also saw that of the elderly who live in poverty, 75% are women. So to me, what the stats are saying is that women, number one, today really cannot afford to depend on somebody else, and in most cases it is men, a man, for their financial well-being. The stats are showing that right now. And number two, it's very, very important that women get educated in money and investing, or more of us are going to end up poor and old. So this is why I speak to women. And I just want to say, for me, I'm probably a very good example of somebody that knew absolutely nothing about the world of investing. In 1989, Robert came to me and he said, it's time we start investing. And I'm like, I don't even know what investing means. I have not a clue. So he began to teach me what his rich dad taught him about investing. And in 1989, I purchased my first rental property. It was a little two-bedroom, one-bath house in Portland, Oregon. And I'll tell you, I had all the fears. I had all the doubts. What if I can't get a tenant? What if the toilet breaks? At closing, my hand was literally shaking. I was terrified. But I went through and I did that first real estate deal. And that first one was the toughest because that was the scariest for me. And what I found out is I learned so much on that first investment that now today, as I stand here today, in the next few days, I'll be closing on a property that is an $8 million property. Thank you. Thank you.
And earlier this year, she already closed on one that's $7.5 million. So she's going to do over $15 million this year. Her portfolio will choke a horse. I mean, she's richer than most men in America. And she's financially independent, which means you don't what?
I don't need you anymore. But I really want you.
Yeah.
So the...
I'm much more well-behaved that she has all that money, too.
For women who want to come talk to me about investing, please do, because I really want to tell you, it's simple, It's not rocket science. It takes time. It takes education. But the rewards are so immense that I just know for me, my self-confidence increases, my knowledge increases. And because, very personally, because I don't need Robert for my finances, what we found out is that we really want to be together. And so I'll tell you, the love and the respect and all of those good things have really increased in our marriage. And that's something I never expected. Thank you. Thank you.
When I met my wife, Kim, I mean, it's really strange. You know, you see, I saw her. She was the most beautiful woman on earth. I couldn't believe it. But naturally, sometimes when you see what you want, you're afraid of more for being rejected. I didn't know what to say to her. And thank God I had sales training, because I asked her out for 6 months. And she said no. And I asked her out 1,000 different ways until finally one day she said yes. So I tried everything. I mean, finally I found out that her best friend was my ex-girlfriend. And what does every salesman do? Ask for a referral. So I called up her best friend, Karen, and I said, tell me, what am I doing wrong? You know, what can I do? And she says, what you're doing, what all the other guys do, is try and wine and dine her. She doesn't like that stuff. I said, what does she like? She just likes moonlight walks on the beach. I said, holy mackerel, that's cheap. I can afford that. I was trying to razzle-dazzle her with money, and it didn't work. So my first date with her was with a bottle of champagne and a walk on the beach, and we've been together ever since.
Okay, so I'm going to wrap this up. The second half, like I said, I advise you to have a partner, because I'm going to be going into a little bit more sophisticated investment strategies. You'll need a partner because, like I said, I'm not going to answer any questions. And if one or two persons is a little confused, you'll be able to talk it over with them and find out how to do it. So for my wife and I to retire young and retire rich, what we had to do Okay. Very simply, we had to have a goal. We had to have a plan, choose our products, and we had to have skills. Now, it was very simple for Kim and I. Well, I misspelled goal. I thought Kim can't spell. I tell you, I'm a creative person, and I'm really a designer at heart here. So our goal was a very simple goal. We started in 1985, and our goal was to have $100,000 a year or more coming in, whether we work or not. And so that, if you look at the game sheet over here, this is passive income of $100,000. It was added to our regular income. Our total expenses at that time, we lived in a very modest house. We paid $117,000 for it. And our total living expenses were approximately $3,000 a month. So we had $100,000 coming in and $36,000 going out. So we could live very well, and we kept investing and stuff like that. It's not really big stuff. So we started in 1985, and it took us 9 years to achieve this. And our plan was very simple. It's the same plan I had that my rich dad gave me years ago. Build business, buy real estate. Build business, buy real estate. That was as simple as it came. The reason I build a business first is this, is growing up in Hawaii, real estate is extremely expensive like it is out here in New York. Many people can't even afford a house because low-income housing in Hawaii starts at $385,000. And the average per hourly wage is $5. So the differentials, they can't afford it. And even apartment houses are so expensive. So the only way I could afford to buy property in Hawaii was start a business, because my income was unlimited there. So when I talk to young people about, you know, I can't afford a piece of property, I say, you know, keep your daytime job, but start a part-time business. And today there's network marketing and things like that. A lot of these franchises, there's a lot of businesses you can start. Like Cecilia came up here, she bought a laundromat. She buys three of them, she triples her income without working that much harder. So there's things you can do. So I like business and buying real estate. So it took me 9 years. It took Kim and I 9 years. Then I retired, I took 2 years off. And then we said, well, that was pretty easy. Let's set another goal. And the goal was then $1 million a year without working. And that took us 5 years to achieve. And the reason it took 5 years to achieve was basically because it was the same plan and the same skills. the benefit of staying in is when, you know, by staying over here, what increases is our knowledge. We've got easier and easier and easier. So what I say to people is this: it takes about 5 years to learn to be a business person. It takes you 5 years to get through college. It takes you 5 years to learn to be a business person. So you may want to join a network marketing company or do something to, you know, get rich. I mean, to start a business. The facts are that most multimillionaires started part-time. Henry Ford started in his garage. Michael Dell started Dell Computers in his dorm room. Hewlett-Packard was started in a garage. So the reason that people get rich is not what they do at their work. They get rich at what they do at their spare time. And so it's the very same principle here. Now, so our goal was $1 million, only took 5 years, and we just keep with the same plans. Like Kim this year is going to put away about $16 million worth of property, putting an extra $100,000 a month in our pocket, and we just add more property. We don't work anymore, we just do the same thing. Does that make sense, you guys, here? That was the way it is. Now, we're going to go into plan here and all this. One of the biggest things I hear from people is they go, oh, I got $10,000. What should I do? And so what they're focusing on is a product. You know, should I buy stocks? Should I buy a mutual fund? Should I buy bonds? You know, should I build a business? And really what they should ask themselves are, what are my what? Skills, what is my plan, and what are my goals? So I get nauseous. It's the most common question I have. I got $10,000, what should I do with it? I'm going, holy mackerel. You gotta know your skills. And when it comes to skills, it's really simple. The people who are S's over here, they have a really hard time because they think they have to do it on their what? Own. And that's the problem. So what you have personal skills, and if you don't have the skills, being a C student, the thing I learned is, but just because I don't know how to do something doesn't mean I can't find somebody on my team who has the skills. So if I don't have the skills, I hire somebody who does. Does it make sense, you guys, here? So that's what my rich dad taught me. Never say, I can't afford it or I can't do something. Because nobody can do everything except people who are S's think they have to do everything. I just get different skills depending upon different products, different plans, and different goals.
My rich dad said there's two ways to get rich. You get rich by being greedy. How much money are you going to make, you know, and what's in it for me, and what are you going to give me? And he said the other way you get rich is by being generous. You know, give and you shall receive. Most people are focusing on receiving versus giving. You know, how much pay raise am I going to get, or what's my salary, what are my benefits? Rather than saying, how can I be of most contribution? It's really simple. You want a smile, you give a smile. You want a punch in the mouth, give one first, you know. Give and you shall receive. So the world is, the word is karma. What you put out does come back. And I trust in that.
I want to say one more thing for the people who like to save money, okay? As I talked it earlier, as a professional investor, this is one of the tips here. It's debt versus equity. Question is, when you look at these two deals, what happens when I use more debt? What happens to my ROI? Cash on cash return. When I use more debt, in other words, I borrow more money, what happens to my return? How many people think it goes up? How many people have no idea what I'm talking about? Okay, I want you to hear something, guys. That is the most expensive thing you can know right now. If you don't know the difference between what happens when you use debt versus equity. See, the problem with the 401k, are you using debt or equity? Equity, money. You're using your money. So the more equity you have, your ROI actually goes down. And the more debt you use, your ROI goes up. So when I say to people, I can get a 50% return, they go, oh, you're a liar. I said, no, you're a loser. And the reason I can jump my return so high is because I'm not using my money, I'm using my banker's money. If you don't understand that, ladies and gentlemen, you're in serious trouble today financially. Because you're probably trying to save your way out of the poorhouse. It is not the way you get there. You need leverage. So I'm going to go into it again. The problem with a 401k is it takes what? Equity, your money. The beauty of real estate, it takes what? Debt. So the less skill you have, the more equity you want, the higher skills you have, the more debt you want, because you can jack your returns here. So that's why people who are saying right now, oh, I'm so afraid, what if I make a mistake? The biggest mistake is to not make a mistake, because you're not learning anything. I mean, you know, like we always say, start with one small deal and stay with it for 1 year, because you have a lot to learn here. But not only that, not only is my ROI better with real estate, there's something else that happens. Like on a cash on cash, this $8 million deal we're doing, cash on cash right here, 17%, okay? Because we have some kind of down payment in there and all this stuff. And the reason we put down payment in there is because, again, I want insurance. And the insurance we bought with a down payment wasn't the down payment. What we bought was called a non-recourse note. In other words, if I fail and the property fails, the bank can't come after me. So non-recourse is another form, what the average investor calls diversify. I call it insurance or protection. So we bought a non-recourse note. There's another thing that's magical about real estate. It's called losses, depreciation. It's a loss, right? That worth 22% on this deal. This is phantom cash flow. When you read a financial, it looks like a loss, but it's really cash flow coming into your pocket. It's a way the government says, keep the money. Okay, so we then ramp our returns at that point to, I hope that's right, 39%. That makes sense, you guys here? That's the beauty of real estate, okay? Please take a moment and discuss that. Even if you don't understand it, just pretend, yeah, it's the depreciation. 30 seconds, discuss. Pretend you know what you're talking about. Thanks.
What turns me on when somebody says, you know, it changed my life, more specifically, one of the earliest examples of it was a young single mom on welfare in New Zealand came up to me. She says, I read your book, I got off of welfare, I bought a business, and I'm financially free right now. And the change in her attitude was stunning. How can you go from single mom on welfare, and what she bought was a medical practice, all doctors work for her, and she has this cash flow every month from the medical practice. The way she bought it was from a doctor who was retiring, and nobody wanted to buy the practice from her, so she says, I'll buy it from you, but I'm gonna pay you from the cash flow. So she got the cash flow from the business, and she paid the doctor back on installment plans. So, I mean, stories like that, you go, wow, why didn't I think of that? Or, you know, it's so powerful at how creative people can be if they're given some insight into how the rich get rich.
The next thing I want to talk about is this. The reason Kim and I could get up to our goal faster was products. And some of the products we have right here are these. When I wrote Rich Dad, Poor Dad over here, this is an asset. Every month it puts money in my pocket whether I work or not. This is an asset. And it's intellectual property. And what I'd like to bring out really quickly, just for a brief moment, is my intellectual property attorney, because this is an asset. Mike Lechter, so hand for Mike here, please. And Mike is the author of Protecting Your Number One Asset. How many people in this room have had a $1 million idea? Yeah. Now, is an idea good without protection?
No. How many of you made money from it? No, if you don't protect your ideas, it's worth zip.
So what he does is he protects my ideas. How many trademarks do we have?
327 worldwide.
How many patents do I have?
Let's see, around 30 worldwide.
And now, how much would you say my ideas are worth today on the open market? My patents?
Figures? About $100 million.
And if I hadn't protected it with his help, it would be worth what?
Zip.
So the thing is, people think I'm a real estate guy. That's not really true. I'm a products guy, and I can change the product. You know, most people, the only product they have is a mutual fund. I can do real estate, businesses, ideas, patents, trademark, and all this. I took the word Rich Dad, which everybody knows, gave it to Mike. He put a trademark around it, and it's worth millions of dollars. Does that make sense, you guys, here? For those of you who have patents or ideas or things you want to protect, he's a guy, because if he hadn't protected it, it'd be worth what?
Zero.
Thank you. It's a hand for Michael here. And it's a thing called legal entities or corporations or things like this. So what happens here is this. Here is Rich Dad. And over here is MC. That stands for the Magic Corporation. Okay. The rich use corporations. My poor dad wants everything in his name. I want nothing in my name. I want everything held either in a corporation or a partnership. Okay? So here's my magic corporation. So what I have over here is I have royalties from my patents and trademarks. I have a very small salary. Why don't I want a big salary? Taxes. I don't want to say, oh, a paycheck, keep it away from me. Oh, evil, evil. And what I'm trying to do is flow royalties to this magic corporation. 85% of the income is from real estate passive income. But there's other kinds of passive income called, you know, with royalties and patents and trademarks and all that stuff. And like the magic corporation suddenly has down here what's called a limited partnership. Okay? This is the structure. And in this little limited partnership sits my real estate. You never want to hold real estate in a corporation. You don't want anything in a corporation. You want it in a partnership. So with that, these things here are protection. Like I said, these are in my insurance packages. The average investor diversifies. The rich person insures or protects. With that, I'd like to bring up the author. He's my advisor. This is Garrett Sutton. Let's have a hand for Garrett here, please. By the way, what school did you go to?
University of California at Berkeley.
And you played rugby there, right?
I did.
And we played rugby against each other at Boston.
Let me, you can see who won.
But, and then you went to law school at where?
The University of California's law school in San Francisco, Hastings College of the Law. Yeah.
So what can you tell us about this little diagram here and why it's important and all this stuff?
Well, let me ask the question. Does our current system encourage litigation? Yes. One in three Americans is going to be sued. I'm from Nevada. Those aren't good odds. You need to protect yourself. And there are a number of entities to do that. There are six entities for doing business. I call them the good, the bad, and the ugly. The bad is a sole proprietorship. You are not going to do business as a sole proprietorship because your assets are exposed.
And most people, when they go in business on their own, form a sole proprietorship.
That's right. They think it's easy, but it offers no protection. The next entity is a general partnership. That is an ugly entity because you are exposed not only for your mistakes, but those of your partners. You're both personally responsible for everything.
In other words, if Sharon and I are partners, if something, she did something like hit somebody in the crosswalk, I have twice the liability and half the rewards. So they can come after me through this general partnership and after me. So you never...
I won't even set up a general partnership for people.
But most accountants recommend general partnerships or sole proprietorships because they don't understand the attorney side of it.
Okay. Or so there are four good entities. C corporations, S corporations, limited liability companies, and limited partnerships. And they're not hard to form. They're not hard to maintain. But by doing so, you'll have protection. You will protect your assets.
The other question I always ask, the battle between is a Delaware corporation and a Nevada corporation. Why a Delaware corporation?
Well, Delaware is great if you're a Fortune 500 company. They have a well-developed body of case law. So, you know, the larger corporations will go to Delaware.
And the little guy goes to?
Nevada.
Why?
Privacy and taxes. In Nevada, it's the only state in the union that doesn't share shareholder information with the IRS. If you want privacy, Nevada is the place to be.
Now, can even a New Yorker form a Nevada corporation?
Absolutely. We let New Yorkers in.
Can a person from Bangladesh form a Nevada corporation?
Right. Anywhere from around the world. We deal with clients from around the world.
So you don't need to apply for U.S. citizenship. All you do is go to Nevada and form a U.S. corporation, which is technically a U.S. citizen.
Correct.
Thank you very much here. Give a hand for him. Thank you. Now, let's bring out Sharon Lecter right now. Okay. Sharon and I are partners. We make equal amounts of money. Equal. But Sharon will pay twice the amount of taxes than I.
Say thank you, Robert.
Yeah, thank you. She pays not 10%, 100% more in taxes. 100%. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Tell them why she will pay 100% more in taxes than me. You're a CPA?
Yes, sir.
Doctors, attorneys, architects, engineers, professional people do not have the same breaks as the C students.
In 1986, the government decided the more education you have, the more taxes you should have to pay.
So that's why we go back again to this. There's not one plan that fits all. There's not one product that fits all. These are assets to me. My losses are assets. I mean, if I have enough intelligence, I can turn anything into an asset. I can turn a bad piece of real estate into assets, good into, you know, things like this. But the thing you want to know is you have to come up with your own goals, your own plans, your own products, and your own skills. And I choose to hire and hang around with very smart people because I was a C student. And the government takes pity on C students and gives them the best tax breaks of all.
And for all of you straight A students, we are forming a new club. It's called Recovering A Students. And you start with Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
So in closing, ladies and gentlemen, that's how the rich play the game. There's one last thing. We go back again to one of the first flip charts I put up here. Demography is destiny. In other words, what is happening demographically is our destiny. Taking the 2000 census, they found out there's 281 million Americans today. By the year 2025, they could be as high as 381 million of them. Now, the reason I like real estate, the reason I recommend the six steps and the basic packages here and all this, get your education up, is because big corporations come and big corporations go. This thing about blue chips are safe is the biggest BS I've ever heard. You can't bet on a blue chip corporation. But there's one thing that's really accurate over here. If you look over here, the one second expense after taxes is housing. That regardless, they have to have a place to live. So if there's going to be an increase of 70 to 100 million Americans, you think real estate's expensive today, wait 10 years. How many of you waited 10 years too long right now? I mean, the prices have kept going up on them. So these idiots who say that, well, there's a real estate bubble, that's good news, because when it busts, that's when you want to what? Buy. Okay, so I'll leave that with you. One of the greatest needs in America today is affordable housing. The reason I get the big tax breaks, I get the 120% financing, I get tax-free credits, I get the high interest rate, I mean the high tax credits and all that, is because I do a very important service to America, is I provide affordable what? Housing. And that's the way it is. Thank you very much, and we'll see you later on. Thank you. The most satisfying thing about this work is I see the spirit go on. I see people get excited. You know, they see the light at the end of the tunnel. That's what I see. Inside each and every one of us is a poor person. And there's a part of me that's still cheap as they come. There's a middle class person that wants security, security, security. And there's a person who's rich. And what I think I see in people who are turned on is my work or the products hit that person that's rich inside them. The spirit comes alive. So the rich spirit comes out and you can see it in their eyes. They get so excited. They're so excited they have the potential to be rich. And what rich means, being financially free and not worrying about paying the bills all the time. So the most satisfying thing is to see the lights go on inside a person. The spirit comes out.